Hi everyone, this is Andrew. Back in 2002, I was living and working in Osaka, Japan, and I had a couple of American mates, one by the name of Joe from New Mexico, and the other one was Dave from Texas. Anyway, everybody referred to Dave as Texas Dave, as there were a couple of other Daves knocking about. You know, Dave was a nice guy. He was always well-dressed, well-spoken. He spoke Spanish fluently. I think his mother was from Mexico. And he also spoke Japanese somewhat too. Joe, on the other hand, he was a bit of a crazy guy. He did lots of crazy things and gave foreigners a bit of a bad name in Japan. Anyway, despite his craziness, I got on well with him and we ended up being quite close friends. So one day Joe invited us, that is Dave and I, to a party. It was out in the suburbs of Osaka. It was quite far out, maybe about 25 kilometers out. I didn't really know the area well. I had only heard the name, but I thought, oh yeah, why not? Let's go along. I wasn't planning to drink very much, so I think I bought a six-pack of beer or something and brought that along with me. Anyway, we arrived at the party. It was kind of a mixed party. We had a fair few Japanese people and a fair few Western people, none of which I had met before. And I thought, oh yeah, this looks okay. Everyone seemed quite friendly. And yeah, I started drinking one of my beers and drank that down and started chatting with people. It was good fun. Anyway, a couple of Japanese guys entered. They kind of were the cool kids. They were kind of dressed in their latest sort of fashion, and I think there was three of them. And they were just talking with people and so on, and I thought, oh yeah, I'll practice my Japanese. So I went up and started speaking with them, and they started using some basic English, and I started using some basic Japanese, and yeah, they were quite friendly. But then most Japanese were quite friendly, I found. Anyway, they offered me a drink, and I said, oh yeah, what is it? And they said, oh, it's a special type of peach drink. And I thought, oh yeah, that sounds okay. I remember it was in a bottle, and it had already been opened. And I remember back to my, university days back in Australia, thinking, oh yeah, I shouldn't be drinking open bottles, you know, they could be spiked or whatever. I thought, ah, these guys seem friendly, what's the harm, right? So I thought, oh yeah, I'll have a shot. So they gave me a small cup, and I had a shot of it. And yeah, it was quite nice. It was quite sweet, quite smooth. It wasn't like having a shot of tequila or something. It was very, very nice. Anyway, they offered me one more, and I thought, oh yeah, why not? I'll have one more. After finishing that drink, I noticed that the Japanese guys wandered off. I don't know where they were going, just maybe off to talk to some other people, and I went back to sipping on my beer. So I was keeping track of how many drinks I had, because I didn't want to get drunk or anything. I just wanted to have a good time, and I wanted to catch the last train home, which usually left about midnight or soon after. I clearly remember that I was on my fourth drink. You know, soon after, I started to feel a bit lightheaded, and I thought, oh, geez, maybe it's a bit hot in this room. There's too many people. There was maybe 50 people in this small little apartment. Maybe it was only a one-bedroom apartment, but that was very normal in Japan. So anyway, I went out onto the balcony. I think we were about three floors up, and I remember slumping down onto the cold concrete floor, and it felt really good because I felt a bit hot inside. And anyway, there were a couple of girls sitting opposite me that just having a chat and a smoke. I think they were Japanese girls. And yeah, they looked at me and kind of laughed. Maybe they thought I was completely drunk or completely wasted or something. But I knew I had only had four drinks, or maybe three and a half drinks, so I knew it wasn't the alcohol. So, and I sat down going, oh boy, I'm feeling really lightheaded. And I started to lie down. Now, that's the last thing I remember of that night. Everything else is blank. I have no idea what happened from then on. And this is where the story gets interesting, or scary, if depending what perspective you have. I woke up in a cage. The sun was just up, just on the horizon, and I was inside some sort of bicycle storage. Now, when I say cage, I don't mean like a lion cage. I mean like a fenced sort of bicycle enclosure. But the fencing was about 10 feet high, and on top there was like barbed wire. I thought, oh my gosh, what's going on here? Now, the bicycles were clearly not in use because they were all rusted and seized up, and it looked like some sort of dumping ground for bicycles, I guess, or maybe what you'd see at the back of a bicycle repair shop or something. Anyway, my first instinct was to try to get out. I noticed that there was a gate, but it was heavily chained, and it looked like it had a big padlock on it, so I raced over to there, and I started sort of trying the gate, and I realized, no, there's no way I'm getting through this. The gate is clearly locked. The chains are wrapped up around the side. You know, I've been locked in. I thought, oh gosh. I was thinking, oh, maybe I could scream out, but then I thought, oh, if I do that, surely the people who've locked me here will hear, and they'll come and I don't know what they'll do, do I? So I thought, I have to keep quiet. I have to keep quiet. And I thought, how am I going to get out of here? Oh, geez, I'm in trouble. Now, I didn't have a phone on me. Wherever that was, I have no idea, but it wasn't on me. So I thought, oh gosh, what am I going to do? I thought the only way I'm going to get out of here is if I climb out. And I had to do it. I had to get out of this cage. Yeah, there was barbed wire. I thought, oh, screw it. I've got to get out. I can't just be, leave myself at the hands of some unknown attackers. So I got off, I took off my shoes and I threw them over. And I started climbing the cage. Now I got to the top. There was barbed wire, but it was kind of really old style barbed wire that wasn't really effective. And I could kind of push it down with my sleeve. So I pushed it down, got over the top. I was kind of right next to the guttering on the building, so I was able to use that to help myself over. And I climbed down the other side, put on my shoes, and I got the hell out of there. I had no idea where I was. It felt like I was kind of out in the sticks a little bit. But I knew that if I went into the city, I'd be able to find a train station. Now, I could see some tall buildings off in the distance, so I started heading that way. And I walked and I walked and I walked. I walked for probably about an hour and a half, and I finally came upon a subway station. Luckily for me, I always kept my train pass in my shirt pocket, and it was still there. Nobody had taken it, and I thought, oh, yippee. So I got on the train, travelled for about maybe 50 minutes on the subway to get back to my station and got home. Now, I was really worse for wear. My brain was not functioning well. Something had happened. Luckily, one of my flatmates was home and he was always up fairly early, and I told him the story, well, just briefly. And he goes, oh, geez, it sounds like Rohypnol. And I thought, oh, what's Rohypnol? And he goes, oh, yeah, recently in Japan, especially in Osaka, there was lots of cases of people getting spiked drinks. And if you've heard of Rohypnol, you know it's a very powerful sedative. So it sounded like that might have been it. Now, I don't know why somebody would have spiked my drink, because I checked my body pretty thoroughly and nothing had happened as such. Maybe they were in it to steal stuff, I don't know, but my phone wasn't like worth anything. It was just a dirt cheap phone. I didn't have much money on me, so that couldn't have been it, but I guess they wouldn't have known that. Or possibly it was just some guys having a bit of a prank, because why would they put me in a cage? I think it was maybe just to scare me. I don't think anybody was intending to do anything with me. I think it was just one big prank. And anyway, the next day I was like hungover. I don't know what sort of feeling, but I was laying in the bathtub, just hungover. I knew it couldn't have been from the alcohol. I'd kept track of my drinking. Although, after reading the effects of Rohypnol, it can lead to erratic behavior and doing stuff that I wouldn't normally do. So it's possible I kept on drinking, maybe. I kept on drinking, even though I can't remember it, and just drank far too much. And with the added effects of maybe a spiked drink, it just completely destroyed me. So it took about probably 24 hours for me to overcome the effects of it. And from that point onwards, I made a promise to myself. One, cut down what I'm drinking. And two, never accept a drink from somebody I don't know, because it's silly. Even if they act very friendly, I made a promise that day never to accept drinks from strangers. And there you go. Life lesson learnt. By the way, I caught up with my two American buddies, Dave and Joe, a couple of days later. Anyway, Joe told me that he had left early, and he had asked me if I wanted to go with him. But I said, no, it's okay, I'll hang about here. None of which I remember. Dave, on the other hand, he said that he had a very similar experience to me. He woke up, not in the cage, but somewhere else, and his pants were completely ripped, his suit jacket was torn, and he was in the middle of nowhere. He managed to walk to a train station similar to me and got home, and he had no idea what had happened. He just thought he had drunk too much. But I told him my experience, and then we realized, no, something went on at that party. But luckily, we all came out of it alive, and I'm here to tell the tale. So, as I said, life lesson learnt. Cheers.